Welcome to At Home with Friends of the Coral Reefers, brought to you by SiriusXM and Margaritaville TV. I'm Mick Gutley.
And I'm Erin McAnally. Today, we're coming to you from separate locations. I'm here in Nashville and Mick is out in Los Angeles. Today, we're very excited to have a chat with a super talented young woman that many of you may be familiar with from hearing her voice on Radio Margaritaville quite a bit these days. Maggie Rose, welcome and thanks so much for being here with us.
Thanks for having me. It's great to meet you guys.
You too. We are excited to get to know you a little bit more. We know a lot of our viewers have heard you on the radio, but can you start out by telling us about your musical background? And we also love to know what people listen to growing up. So maybe tell us about that and how you first started playing and singing.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, for those of you listening who can't see me, I'm wearing a Bruce Springsteen t-shirt in honor of my musical origins, because I grew up singing in church like most singers, but when I first got to get on a stage in real life and help people escape into music was when I was playing with a Bruce Springsteen cover band, and they are called the B Street Band, not to be confused with the E Street Band, and they are out of the Jersey Shore, and I grew up in Potomac, Maryland, outside DC, so my parents were incredibly supportive and would drive me up there to link up with these guys, and they started helping me play my original music, and we'd play venues like the Headliner in Neptune, New Jersey, and it was just those miles on the mic, you know, where you realize that it's not about being a technically great singer, it's about giving people something to enjoy and just help them kind of relax into and start their weekend and feel like they have something to connect to. And then I also grew up during the era of the female singer, the diva reigned supreme. We had so many wonderful female vocalists when I was growing up, like Faith Hill and Shania Twain, and even Madonna and Mariah Carey and Whitney Houston, and just the abundance of really gifted female singers in pop music was a gift, because I always had something to sing along with, and I had someone to belt it out with. So it was pretty awesome.
So very true. Cool.
Well, how did you wind up becoming an artist, transitioning from singing like Bruce to becoming your own artist, and sort of what or who first brought you into the music industry?
Well, with the B Street Band, they have an amazing lead singer, Glenn Stewart, who actually resembles Bruce Springsteen. So he would do all the Bruce, and I was more the Patty, and they actually backed me up when I was in my opening set for them. And we'd do all sorts of covers, No Doubt, Lucinda Williams. It was quite a cool compilation of songs. But then I, with my original music, realized that I loved performing and that I loved the art of writing a song. And I got linked up with Tommy Mottola through a family friend who has been a supporter of mine since I moved to Nashville 13 years ago. And Tommy Mottola was my liaison to Nashville and introduced me to one of the first producers that I worked with in Nashville, James Stroud. And I was a teenager. I was studying music at Clemson, and I got this awesome opportunity to go to Nashville and work with this amazing caliber of producers and musicians. And I decided to leave Clemson in the middle of my sophomore year and pursue a career full time, and it was definitely baptism by fire. If you guys know anything about Nashville, which you do, there's so many amazing musicians everywhere. Just your barista is probably a better guitar player than you've heard anywhere, and just made me step up my game. You know, it was the standard that is set here made me become a better musician pretty quickly. And there's been a lot of evolution in that 13 years as an artist, and even in my musical taste and the music that I'm making.
Well, speaking of Nashville, your first records were maybe a little more country leaning, but can you talk about how your sound has evolved over the years and maybe some about the music that's influencing your work these days?
Yeah, absolutely. Nashville has evolved a lot as well. I feel like my evolution is correlated with how diverse this town has become. And when I moved here in 2008, I loved the art of country music and the truth that you can find in country lyrics and I think that that still is very much prevalent in my music. And I am a product of all the things I've learned just from being in Nashville. But I feel like my album Change the Whole Thing really showed me a lot about what my capabilities are as a singer. I was able to do this album live with a bunch of my friends in one tracking room, no isolation booths, and no auto-tune or comping it together. And I realized, like, okay, I'm a soul singer and there's so much life to this music. And the country industry is just, it's a little restrictive when it comes to the exposure that they're giving to women, to be completely frank. And that was something that I kind of dealt with, which luckily pushed me to explore other sounds of music. And now I've wound up here, and I decided that I wanted to make a record down at Fame Studios in Muscle Shoals, which is just legendary for artists like Aretha Franklin and Percy Sledge and the Allman Brothers and Etta James and Rolling Stones, and the list goes on. And when I got that in my mind, that definitely shaped the music that I was writing for this forthcoming record, Have a Seat. And we tracked it before the pandemic.
Can't wait to hear it.
Definitely.
I'm so excited. I'm glad we waited to put it out, because now it feels like just a celebration with things reopening and us getting ready to hit the road. And with what we've all been through collectively, this music resonates with me even more than I think it did when we tracked it in the end of 2019.
Well, switching gears a little bit, do you remember the first Jimmy Buffett song you ever heard?
Yes, I remember where I was when I heard it. I was like 6 years old in Key West, Florida, and we were at Margaritaville, the original restaurant, and on the wall they had the lyrics to Cheeseburger in Paradise. And I was like, I want the Cheeseburger in Paradise that this song is about. And I learned the lyrics for all those lists of condiments and felt really proud of myself. And like, I was having the burger that he was talking about in that song. I just remember feeling like this was the only one that he was singing about. And it was a really good burger.
That's amazing. I've never tried it. We'll have to
Heinz do that. 57 and French fried potatoes, the whole deal. I had it.
Yeah. Cold draft beer.
I didn't have that part.
Yeah. 6 years old. Six is a little young.
Maybe I snuck like a sip or something, but I don't think that I liked it as much as I do now at my age.
Have you ever seen Jimmy play live?
I have. I took my parents and my in-laws to a New Year's Eve concert at Bridgestone Arena in Nashville to see him play. And it was super fun because, you know, I think Parrotheads are already pretty dedicated fans, but on New Year's Eve and ringing it in with the band and everything was pretty awesome to see. And I think my parents really enjoyed it too. So that was how we brought in 2018.
Do you feel a special connection to Cheeseburger when you hear it live?
Yeah, absolutely. I want a cheeseburger right now. It's that one sounds just particularly delicious. Absolutely. And that night he sang Fins, and from where we were sitting, we looked down at the audience and everyone went left at the same time and went right at the same time. And it was pretty cool to see like the whole crowd moving in sync like that. And that's just something that I'm so excited to get back to this summer, is just seeing people gathering together like that and enjoying themselves, and just feels almost tribal. It's awesome.
Well, do you have a favorite Buffett song besides Cheeseburger?
Absolutely. I have one song that my dad, I grew up in Maryland and there's a lot of water around there. And so my mom and dad are big boat people. And every time we take my dad's boat out, he wants to play Son of a Sailor. And there's all of us kind of packed on the boat together and we all sing it together. And that's, as we're going out, the first thing that we have to put on just out of tradition. And it's the sign of a good day. I feel like I associate only good memories with that song. And you know, you're about to have a nice little afternoon with some family time and some cold beers and hopefully sunshine. If not, it's still fun.
Well, this show was sort of born out of the pandemic because it's an at-home special. But we're wondering what your year's been like, and now that things are opening up a bit, if you're getting ready to head out back on the road.
We are getting ready to head out, and my cheesy dad joke is that we're going from 0 to 60 because we just announced 60 dates that we're doing between now and New Year's Eve.
Wow. And
I'm so excited. I know it's going to be intense and grueling, but I think we're all just like, let's make up for lost time. We want to see the fans. I think that we have missed them more than they have missed us. I really believe that. And with this new music, it's a celebration. And I think that a lot of the themes in my record, Have a Seat, are about inclusivity and gathering and coming together and the collaborative energy that went into this music. So to pair it with a bunch of shows and just being out on the road and getting to crisscross the country a couple of times feels just like the perfect way to celebrate having waited this long to put this music out. And I can't wait. I will never not be grateful for the opportunity to do what we do, especially after this year. It's kind of like having had the flu for a while and then your taste buds start kicking in again. And you just are so grateful for the ability to even do this.
That's awesome. Tell us about your first single.
So the first single that we put out was called Do It from this record. And you guys have been generously playing it, so thank you. But that was something I wanted to start with because it feels like a celebration and it feels like this declaration of independence and that strong sense of self. And I felt like after everything that we've all collectively been through, I wanted to give some happiness to people and I wanted to put something joyful out there first as the first impression that you're going to get from this project. And, you know, Have a Seat, that title on a macro level is about all those things I mentioned, like inclusivity and making room for everybody to have a seat at the table, but also just from a musical standpoint with where I've been falling on the musical spectrum in all my years in Nashville, I've kind of had this feeling of not belonging somewhere or transcending genre and having a difficult time putting my finger on what exactly that music is and what I want to call it. And I don't feel that way anymore. I feel like I've finally found my sound and I feel comfortable there and like I own it. So Do It felt like a really great way to substantiate that idea and drive that point home that we can just be exactly who we are and we can't be anybody else. Only we can fill that seat.
So Maggie, you just put out a new single, right? For Your Consideration, is that right?
That's right. Yes. And we kind of had a really cool, dramatic way to release it to the world. I was up in New York City on June 4th, the day that the single dropped. And it also happened to be my 5-year wedding anniversary with my husband, Austin. We work together as well, like you guys. And he's like, let's go down to Times Square. And I was like, okay, I love Times Square. We don't usually hang in that neighborhood when we go to New York, but still we were walking around and my friend John Murray showed up and he's kind of trying to distract me and point me in all these directions. And then they point me towards this giant screen in Times Square at the Viacom building and the video premiere airs on that screen in the middle of Times Square. And it was just so cool because we made 3 music videos and that is the 3rd and final video in that series. And that song is about communication. It's about all the internal struggles that I think we've all had that have been magnified by this period of time being in isolation and just having the presence of mind to be able to be clear-headed and at least give each other the space to speak their minds. So it was so cool to see it, 10 times bigger than human form on a screen in such an iconic spot. And I think it really is a great focus track for the record because it's just about compassion for one another and sitting at the table and hashing it out and listening to each other.
Awesome. It's such a cool picture too. Everybody should check out Maggie's socials so you can see the picture.
There's many Maggies at the table. There's a lot of clones in the video, which was a way for us to safely shoot it during this time because you can't hire a bunch of actors, but then it's also just the symbolism of, you know, having all those voices of negativity or doubt or whatever clashing within us and trying to quiet those voices.
Absolutely. Well, we have been playing a game with everyone that comes on the show, a little word association game. So we're going to throw out a few words, and you can have a one word reaction, or you can have you can tell us a story, however you feel. So we'll
These
just
are
go
always
back.
Very revealing, but yes,
let's go. Cool. Don't be scared. It's all good. Mm-hmm. All right. We'll start with Margaritaville.
Burger.
Awesome.
Obviously I know what I'm eating for dinner tonight.
Perfect. Okay. Body on fire.
Champagne.
Awesome. I'm going to have some champagne tonight now.
Right. Maybe champagne and a burger together.
Yes. Sounds perfect. Right. We talked about this a little bit already, but Fame Studios.
The Swampers, the musicians that they have in Muscle Shoals, the Swampers, who've made so many records in there, just incredible. And I had David Hood, who played on Mustang Sally, and all those records play on many of the tracks on this record. So Muscle Shoals and the Swampers go together like peanut butter and jelly, like cheeseburgers and beer.
Or champagne.
We've got quite the meal going now.
Yeah.
PBJs, cheeseburgers, right. Champagne. Okay, one more. Them Vibes.
Family. That's they're an incredible band in their own right. And they have amazing original material, but they've also been touring with me for years and years. And I write a ton of songs with them, particularly with Brother Love and Alex. And I just feel so supported by them, and having them on stage with me is a gift.
Do you have a favorite Maggie Rose song, or maybe even top three, or too hard to choose?
It's pretty hard to choose. I think from one week to the next, I will kind of be in love or looking forward in the set to one song more than another, but I always will love Smooth from Change the Whole Thing. I think that that's just like so fun and groovy, and people always seem to get moving to it. There's a song on this record that I wrote with Marcus King called What Makes You Tick. That's also really fun. And every time we play it live, it is different from one show to the next. So it's cool to have that spontaneity on stage that comes with that song. And obviously I love For Your Consideration. There's another song on this record called Saint that we've released already that I think is just a really magical song. It always feels like a meditative moment when we get to sing that. And It's You. I love It's You from Change the Whole Thing. I really like this material. I'm so excited to be able to play it all. So it's tough to choose. They're kind of like your babies.
Awesome. Are y'all in rehearsals now, getting ready to go out?
Yes. Yeah.
Awesome. Is it fun to be
rehearsing?
Be back with the band rehearsing?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think those endorphins and that serotonin that you can only get on stage and when you're rehearsing in a room, like, we're definitely feeling the effects of that. And not having that has been a pretty big amputation, but now that it's flowing again, I think just the excitement is ramping up, and it's hard to even realize that you're exhausted when you have all that other stuff going for you.
Well, for this next question, if I were you, I would be mad at me for asking this. but it is something that I'm really curious about. If you had to pick one album of all the albums ever made to go to a desert island, what would you pick?
I am mad at you for asking me that. 'cause there's so many. I mean, there's instrumental records I love, like Herb Halpert's Tijuana Brass, Whipped Cream and Other Delights. I think that's just a mood. I love Carole King, Tapestry. I think over the pandemic, especially listening to that on vinyl, was just really inspiring. Her songwriting is incredible. And we actually worked up a new version of I Feel the Earth Move. That's very, it's a different interpretation of that song, but Rumors, Fleetwood Mac is just so dynamic. All that material is exceptional. Sgt. Pepper's, I'm naming so many. Bill Withers Live at Carnegie Hall is my favorite live record. So yeah, that's a tough one.
It's a tough one. It's also kind of an antiquated question because now we have all the music in the world on our phone. So
it's never going to be an antiquated question. I feel like, how much time do you have? We can just keep this going after the interview and have some champagne and talk about all our favorite records. We were over at our friend's house last night organizing his record collection, and it took 3 hours longer than it had to because every album we were passing around as we were alphabetizing it came with a story or this urban legend about what happened when this song was recorded. And I love that question, and I hate it because it's torturous. You can't ever feel like you can satisfyingly answer it.
Yeah, so true.
Yeah.
So Maggie, you have a podcast, right? Tell us about that.
It's called Salute the Songbird, and I've launched it with Osiris Media, which is a great company that has all these really interesting podcasts for audiophiles. But I'm kind of one of the few female podcasters with that company, and I wanted all of my guests to be guests who have a perspective as a woman in the industry. And some of my guests are newer artists that I'm getting to introduce people to, and others are like Nancy Wilson from Heart or Kathy Valentine from the Go-Go's. And we just had Amethyst Kia, who just released an incredible album on for season two. And it's been really wonderful work that has saved me during this time, because it's allowed me to just do research that has made me a better musician. It's made me so appreciative of my peers and of the women who've inspired me to get into music in the first place. And I realize everyone has paid their dues, and everyone has kind of gone through the grind to be able to do what they do, and just makes me a more deeper lover of music. And I want to give more credit to these women who've done so much for us in what they've done with their music.
Absolutely. That's awesome. Well, is there anything else that we didn't talk about that you got going on that you want to mention?
I mean, we covered tour dates, the album. I think you guys did an amazing job. We got it all.
Well, thank you.
So is there any, you have 60 dates for the rest of the year?
60 and that's possibly nuts, more. Possibly.
Is there anywhere you're not going?
No region of the continental US that we are not going.
Excellent.
So they've all been announced, and it's the Have a Seat Tour. Them Vibes is doing a ton of the opening dates. And my friend Dylan Hartigan, who just released an amazing single called Crazy. I met him when I was out on the road with Kelly Clarkson. He's doing a bunch of opening dates as well. And those are all on my Instagram at I Am Maggie Rose. And then my website, maggierosemusic.com, has all the tour dates and ticket information there as well. So we're coming to a city near you, basically. Guaranteed.
Awesome. Perfect. Well, thank you so much. It's great talking to you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, it was great talking to you guys. I really appreciate your time and your support, and I hope to meet you in person soon.
Yeah, absolutely.
I can't wait to tell my dad that I got to talk about my tradition of son of a sailor with you guys.
That's a very sweet tradition. I like that a lot.
It's awesome.
Well, really appreciate you, and can't wait to check out the record. Congratulations.
Thank you guys. Thank you.
All right, well, take care. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Bye. Talk to you soon.